Okay, so let's look at the next part, which is how do we can generate the block cipher from the PRG, pseudorandom generator. So we already look at the, if we have a PRF or PRP, pseudorandom function, then we can generate the pseudorandom generator, right? So let's look at the opposite one. If we have a pseudorandom, secure pseudorandom generator, then how we can construct the secure pseudorandom function. Okay, so then let's look at how we can generate, or how we can build a secure pseudorandom function from the secure pseudorandom generator. It's not so hard. So let's assume that we have a pseudorandom generator, which is generating the two size of the input value. Okay, so if the key is given, so k bit key is given, then using the pseudorandom generator, it is generating the double size of the output. Okay, so this is also k bit using the input value. Okay, so if we have this secure PRG, then using this PRG, we can make a pseudorandom function. Okay, so first, I'll just think about that pseudorandom function means we have to give the key value and input value, then it is generating some output. Right? This is a pseudorandom function. Okay, so here let's just think about that this key value is just 1 bit. Key is only 1 bit. So how we can do the case then? Simply we are defining like this. If it is 0, then we are saying that, let's say the first one, G, K zero part and G K one part. So let's assume that. Then F zero comma X is defined as G X zero. If key is one, then we are defined that we are taking the right part of the output. Just left part and right part, we are just choosing. Okay, so it's just 1 bit, right? It looks secure because as we know that this looks like a random, and this is random, so that F value will be also looks like a random, right? So it's okay. But if this is the input k, it's not 1 bit, it's more than 1 bit, it's like m bit. So how we can build then the secure pseudorandom function? Okay. Then we are applying this procedure multiple times. So we are applying these things n times. So for instance, this is 2 bit. 2 bit, which means that F is 0, 1, X. In this case, what we are doing is we are applying the K, so this is actually X. Then after G is applied, then it is generating the G X 0, G X 1, right? So the first bit is 0. So we are taking the left part. And using this left part, we are applying G again. And 0 part. GX 0 and 1. Okay, so the next bit is 1, so we are taking the white part. So we are defining F 0 1 comma X is GX. We are taking left part and then right part. Yeah. So we are just expanding this procedure n times. Then, so we are applying the G n times. Then we can make a F K X, right? So if we have a 3-bit, we can apply this 3 times. So if we have a PL G, then we can make a PLF, right? So if we are applying the PL G multiple times, we can make it. Okay, so that's all. That's the basic idea. So extending the PLG, if we are applying the G 2 times, then we can support 2-bit key value. If it's 3-bit, it's 3 times we apply. Okay, so then this one, this 2-bit case is secure. If this is secure, so I'll assume that this is secure. If this is secure, then PRF is also is secure. No, actually, G is secure. G is secure. And G1 is also secure. PRG. The reason is, we are applying the G 1 time, then there is output. Then we know that this output is same to the lambda, right? Because G is secure. G is secure, so this looks like lambda. So we cannot distinguish with the polynomial time algorithm. So this output of G looks like lambda. And then input is lambda, then we are applying the G, then output looks like also lambda, right? Because G is secure, PLG. Right part case also, if G input is lambda and G is applied, then output looks like a lambda. We cannot distinguish. So every output looks like lambda, right? So even we are applying the 2 times, it still looks like a lambda. Right, so G1K is indistinguishable from the lambda. So G1K is also secure to the random generator because we cannot distinguish it. Okay, so it's a 2-bit. 3-bit is also same thing. So we are applying the G 3 times. 3 times. So K is like a 0, 1, 0. In that case, we are taking the left part. And then from left, we are right, and then left. So this is the upper part. Okay. So we are applying the G triple times, so we can make a compute PL random function value. Okay, so this extension is called GGM. GGM model, GGM PRF. So we are dividing the input as a bit stream. So here in this case, instead of taking the dividing K into the bit, is that it is taking the message as a bit, okay? So key is given, the message is 1-bit message, and then message is 2-bit, and message is m-bit. So message is m-bit case, same thing. So first, the first bit is looked And GK, that is generating the sum bit stream. Then the first bit is zero, then left is taking, first bit is one, and right is checking. So for this taking, we are applying the G again, okay, as input. So this is K1. And then next bit, by looking at the left, next bit, if it's zero, then we are taking the left part. If it's one, then taking the right part. So we are keeping this procedure again and again. Okay. So G is a secure PLG, then F is also a secure PLF, because we already know that K1 is a secure PLG, K2 is a secure PLG, K3, Kn, everything is secure. So everything looks like lambda. Lambda. So we can say that this is a secure PLF. So theoretically, this is a secure. So theoretically, we can make a secure PLF from the secure PLG. But actually, it's not useful in the practice. The reason is it's very slow, right? So instead of it, we are just using the SASA 20 and some other implementation. So we are just using the existing pseudo random generator rather than pseudo random function, or we are just using the AES as a pseudo random function rather than using the SASA 20. Okay, so this is already PLF. But anyway, we can make it. Okay. So using PLG, pseudo random generator, we can make a pseudo random function, right? What about that? If we have a pseudo random generator, then can you make a pseudo random permutation also? What about this? What is your answer? You can or you can't, or depending on the pseudo random generator. So the answer is, right? So GGMPLF, so GGMPLF, we can make a PLF. And if we have a secure pseudo random function, then we can make a pseudo random permutation using what? We learn about the DES algorithm, right? One network, five-star network. So five-star network case, if we have a pseudo random function, right? Then left part, right part, this is copied here and X word. So we are applying this network three times, then it is secure. That is proven by, that is called the Ruby Lakoff theorem, right? So we didn't prove it, but anyway, it is appearing. So using this five-star network, then if we have an existing pseudo random function, then we can make a pseudo random permutation, which is immutable, right? So everything is related. Okay. Okay, so we learn about the pseudo random generator, pseudo random function, pseudo random permutation. So using these things, let us make a real encryption algorithm. Okay, so let's make a cipher system. Okay, pseudo random permutation. Mm. So when we are making the encryption algorithm, we have to think about the secure, right? So we have our goal is to build secure encryption algorithm using secure PLP, like AES. So we have AES, but using the AES is not guaranteeing that the encryption algorithm is secure. Okay, so we have to use AES to make a cipher text. Okay, so before we are making this scheme, we have to decide the security, and also we have to think about the what's the attacker's power, adversary's power. Okay, always we have to think about it. So we have to think what is adversary's power and what is adversary's goal. Okay. So first we are thinking about one-time key. So key is only used one time. Okay. One-time key means that address only look at the one ciphertext pair. Because for the given message, plain text, only one cipher is generated. And the other one, different key is used. So it's independent, which means that only one pair of plain text and ciphertext is given. Okay, so that's the adversary's power. So we will look at the stronger power than this one. But anyway, this is a least powerful adversary. So adversary only look at the similar ciphertext. And goal of adversary is extracting any information about the plain text from ciphertext. So we are using the semantic security. Okay. So others are trying to break semantic security, but others only knows one single ciphertext. Okay, so next time we will look at the main time keys first, but before that we are just looking at the one time key. So maybe you are thinking that just using the AES will be a secure cipher system, right? But actually it's not. The reason is, actually the message size is longer than the block size, right? So let's assume that plain text is given and this is one block. So the plain text message size is longer than the block size. So multiple blocks will be composed of single message. Then the simplest encryption mode is electronic codebook mode, ECB mode. ECB mode. So here what this one is doing is, if we have AES, for instance, AES is a secure pseudo random permutation, then we are just applying this AES for each block. So we are just applying for every block with the same key value. Okay. So we are just simply applying the pseudo random permutation for each block. Then this is not secure. The reason is if M1 and M2 are equal block, so every message is equal, then ciphertext, what about the ciphertext value? These are also equal because the same key is used. Right? So input is equal, then because AES is a deterministic algorithm, so input is same key is used, then output will be same. Okay, so ciphertext will be the same. So that information is leaked, actually. So equality information is leaked. So maybe you're thinking that that is not going to be so severe. Let's look at the example. Okay. So the left one is just plain text. Okay, so just human figure. Right one is encrypted with AES in ECB mode, electric codable mode. So can you see anything from this ciphertext? So this is ciphertext. Can you see? So what can you see there? You don't know exactly, but you can see that there is some boundary, right? This boundary. Right? You can see something. So maybe you can distinguish, you can know that this will be some encryption of some human face, right? So the information is leaked. So ECB mode is leaking some information about the plain text. So ECB is insecure. So you have not to use the ECB mode. Okay. We are defining the semantic security. So we already know about the semantic security, right? Semantic security, definition of semantic security using the game, right? So there is a challenger and there is adversary. Do you remember? Challenger is selecting two messages and then is given the message. Then B is choosing, challenger is choosing one B and selecting one of the messages and encrypting ciphertext. Then this ciphertext is given, then adversary is determining what's the B value, right? Which message is encrypted. So then advantage of this algorithm, adversary, over this one-time path case, semantic security, is that probability A is outputting zero when B equals zero case, minus B prime is zero when B equals one. Right? So that's the difference is called advantage. Okay. So that's the definition. If this is negligible, then we are saying that this is secure, right? So then using this definition, we will show that the ECB mode is insecure. Okay, so we'll show that. Okay, so how we can do is, so there is a challenger. And there is adversary. So adversary can choose any message, right? So adversary is choosing any message. So adversary is choosing the two blank messages. Okay, so like for instance, the first one is hello. And hello world. The second message is hello, hello. Of this. Okay, so there's two messages given. Then challenger is choosing one bit. Key is choosing from key space. And then encryption of one of them. So encryption of using key and one message is chosen and then output is generated. Okay, so the upper size is also two block size, right? Because input is two block size. So I'll put this first block and second block. Okay, so this is one ciphertext, but it is two block size. Okay, so then how address A can distinguish whether this is from the M0 or this is from the M1? If C1 is equal to the C2, then is it M0 or M1? It is M1. Otherwise, okay, so we are making this kind of adversary. Then what's the advantage for this ECP mode? So the advantage is defined like this, right? B prime is zero if B is zero case. B prime is zero, B is one case. So what's the first probability? B equals zero. So hello world is chosen. Then definitely she wants it to be different. So it is returning one, right? What about the second case? B equals one. And in that case, she wants it to be equal. In that case, B prime is one, so always, so it will be zero. So the advantage is one. So one is non-negligible, right? It's much larger than negligible. So it's insecure because we can make a efficient algorithm A, right? So we can make a this kind of algorithm A. Algorithm A case, algorithm A is choosing the message, right? Any arbitrary message, like this message, hello, hello, hello world. For this message, so you can distinguish it. Okay, so then, we know that ECP mode is insecure, right? So how can you construct the secure cipher system using secure pseudorandom permutation or pseudorandom function? What kind of cipher system did he run? We only learn about the We learn the stream cipher, right? We learn the stream cipher. What's the stream cipher? The one-time pad is not so PRG, right? Pseudorandom generator. If we have a secure pseudorandom generator, then XOR with message, then is a secure stream cipher, right? If G is secure, G is secure. So we will use this approach also. So instead of secure pseudorandom generator, we will use secure pseudorandom function. Okay, so we will use this one. So how we can do? So stream cipher case, message is very long, right? Very large message. Okay, what do we do? We are doing the XOR with some GK, pseudorandom generator. But we don't have a GK, right? We only have function. Okay. F. But F case, it is only generating one block, So F, this one is only generating one block. But here we have to generate the second block and third block and last block, right? So what do? We are giving input value, k comma zero, f k comma one, k comma two. It's like this. Then the output of this value will be, looks like random, right? Because f is random function, secure pseudo random function. So this looks like random. And second one is also looks like random. Random. Everything is like random. So this stream is looks like random. So after XOR, that's the ciphertext. Okay. So this kind of encryption mode is called deterministic counter mode. So it's counter mode, right? Because we are giving some counter. First is zero. Second, one is just counter. Two is an increasing counter. Okay, so the counter is starting from the zero. So always is from the zero, it's fixed. So whenever we are applying this counter mode, the starting is always deterministic. So that we are saying that this is deterministic counter mode. Okay, so this deterministic counter mode is using the pseudo random function. So encryption of deterministic CTR counter mode KM. Key K and message M. In the case, we have to divide message into the multiple blocks and key case. The first one, we are giving the counter. One, two, and then doing the XOR operation. Then ciphertext for each block. So for this function F, we are using the AES or triple S. Because AES is also pseudo random permutation, pseudo random function. Right? So after we are making the pseudo random function, so after we are applying the AES, the output is XORed with message. Then it is called deterministic counter mode. So this is secure. Okay, so not just applying the message into the AES directly. That is not secure. Okay, ECM mode is not secure. So as you can see that, determine counter mode case, this value, every block has different bit stream, right? Because counter are different, counter values are different. Okay, determine counter mode is actually secure. How much is it secure is that the advantage of determine counter mode case, so there is attacker. And there, if this attacker is existing, then using that attacker, we can make another attacker, which is breaking the pseudo random function, PRF. So if some attacker can break deterministic counter mode, then using that attacker, we can build another attacker, which is breaking the like AES system. Okay. So if attacker A is a succeeding epsilon probability, then attacker B can succeed half of epsilon probability. So epsilon is high, then Ortega B is also breaking the AES algorithm. Okay. But actually, we don't have any existing algorithm that is breaking the AES. So we can say that determinant counter mode is secure. So the proof is very similar to the stream cipher proof. So in the stream cipher, we are led to look at this kind of things, right? We are led to look at it. So it's like this. I'm not showing the detailed formal proof, but anyway, it's like this. There is challenger, adversary. Adversary is choosing the two messages as given. Then what the challenger is doing is, challenger is choosing the N0 message and then XORed with some pseudorandom function sample. Okay, so that will be ciphertext. Then this is similar to the polynomial time. The F itself, this is a secure PLF, which means that this looks like a random function. So random function. Random function. Right. So if this is random, then M0 XOR, M1 XOR are indistinguishable, right? M0 XOR random, M1 XOR random. It's exactly the same. We already look at the one-time path, right? One-time path, we already look at that XOR with random, then it's just random. So actually it is in this slide, it is saying that in the polynomial time, we cannot distinguish, but actually it's the exactly the same. Okay, statically using the same. And if the random function is similar to the pseudorandom function, so it is in the polynomial time, we cannot distinguish. So that it is secure. So the proof system itself, proof approach is exactly the same to the stream cipher proof. Okay, so using this deterministic counter mode, we can make a encryption algorithm, cipher algorithm, using the existing secure pseudorandom function or secure pseudorandom permutation. If we are applying the key once, okay, so this is possible. But actually, in many cases, we have to use the key multiple times, so many times. So every time we are using the key, using the key again and again, right? So in that case, the scheme should be still secure. So how we can make a secure cipher, even we are using the key multiple times. Okay, the security definition for the many time key, semantic security for many time key is very similar. So address goal is the same. This is breaking the semantic security. You know the semantic security, right? Adversary is choosing the M0 M1, and challenger is encrypting one of them, and then adversary is distinguishing. So leaking any information from the ciphertext, that is called semantic security. So goal is same. The difference is that adversary's power that is changing. So one-time key case, one-time key. Adversary power is ciphertext only. So one ciphertext and message pair is known to the adversary. Okay, so adversary is just receiving one ciphertext. Many time key case, adversary can get many ciphertext. So message M, C1, another message, C2, another message, and for each message, same key is used. Okay, so that is called many time key. So here, what we are assuming is that adversary has a power to encrypt for any message. So here, adversary's power is can obtain or can encrypt, obtain the encryption of arbitrary message of his choice. So adversary, inside adversary, adversary can execute encryption algorithm. So adversary can ask encryption. So actually, for the message M, then a challenger should be answering about the encryption using the same key. Okay, so that kind of power is called Trojan Plain Text Attack, CPA. Trojan Plain Text Attack. So adversary can choose any plain text to encrypt. So adversary has a very powerful power, right? Adversary can encrypt any message. That is called many time key. That is called the Trojan plain text attack. In the real life, this is not gonna be happening, right? In the real life, others only know about some given message and some given ciphertext. That is real life. But anyway, this Trojan plain, if we can make some algorithm or cipher, which is secure against Trojan plain text attack, then we can say that this is really secure because Trojan plain text attack case, adversary has a very high power, right? Adversary can encrypt any message, but still the cipher cannot be broken, then we can say that our system is very secure, right? So we have to keep in mind the Trojan plain text attack. So we learned two things, adversary's power. One is ciphertext only and Trojan plain text attack. Okay. So Trojan plain text attack is a more powerful thing. So Trojan plain text attack case, the key can be used multiple times. So in the doing is like there is challenger and adversary. In the semantic security of the ciphertext only case, adversary can ask two messages, then cipher is given, right? Then it is determining whether this is B prime. In the CPA case, in addition to the last one, that's the semantic part, others can ask encryption of some message. For many times. n times. Okay, q times you can ask. So using that information, using this information, still others cannot distinguish whether cyphertext is coming from the M0 or M1, then we can say that this is a semantically secure against Trojan plain text attack. So the only thing is that others can ask encryption of multiple things. Then you can know that actually if the encryption scheme is deterministic means that every time it is generating the same output for the same input, then is it secure? Secure against CPU attack. So encryption is a deterministic. Then can you make a secure scheme against CPA, Trojan plain text attack? What do you think about it? If the encryption is a deterministic, for the same message, same ciphertext is generated. In that case, the scheme can be secure against Trojan plain text attack, not secure. Why not? The simplest way is challenger. Adversary. So adversary is asking about the N0. And C0 is given, right? And then M1. C1. And then giving M0 and M1. Then something CB is coming. Then what adversary is doing? Adversary is doing that. CB is equal to the C0, then if I miss 0. If it's deterministic, then for the same plain text, same ciphertext is generated. So M0 and M1 is given, then CB is generated. CB is one of them. C0 or C1, right? One of them. Because it's deterministic. Okay. Because encryption is using the same key. And it's deterministic, which means that if input is M0, then it's always generating the C0. If input is M1, then it's always generating the C1. So then, easily others can break the semantic security. Right? So under a CPA attack, Trojan plant test attack, the cipher should be randomized. So encryption of message M0, then output is randomized. So whenever M0 is encrypted, then output is not single thing. We don't know which one. So random should be always provided. Okay, so it's a randomized algorithm. So for the multi-time key case, the ciphertext size is a little bit larger than that plaintext size, because ciphertext should be including random. Okay, so that's the difference. This is randomized. So let's look at this. So randomized encryption to solve that thing. So M0, M1, and encryption, then we don't know which one, but it's randomized. And decryption is going to the same thing. But for the encryption, it's not. So challenger, adversary, when the first M0 is asked, then C0. And later, another M0 is asking, then maybe C0 prime. So every time different ciphertext is generated. So roughly, ciphertext itself is including the random part. So roughly, ciphertext size is plaintext size plus random bit. Ciphertext is including some random parts. So ciphertext must be longer than plaintext if we assume the randomized encryption. Okay, so let's look at some example. F is secure pseudo random function. So key and some value and M. Okay. So F is something input and output and key. Okay, so then we are defining encryption algorithm like this: K, key, message M. Then what we are doing is we are choosing random part. All is random, and then outputting that random with pseudo random function K, F, K, R. It looks like a random, right? With XOR M. That's the output value. Okay, so then this encryption E is a semantically secure on the CPA. What is your answer? If all is large enough, so very large space, then so small r will not be repeating, right? So every time small r, different small r is chosen. If different small r is chosen, then f, k, comma r looks like random bit, right? Just random. Because small r is different every time. So it's random XOR M means it is secure. So the R space, random space is large enough, then is this semantically secure? Okay. So this thing is a typical approach to make a secure cyber system under Trojan plaintext attack. It's very similar to the string cipher, right? Determined counter mode. The only difference is that it is including random part. That's the only difference. The others are almost the same thing. So anyway, what we know that is cipher is including some part which is never repeating. Every time we are encrypting different value is used, then we can guarantee that no information is leaked from the ciphertext, right? If every time is different. So first one is a randomization. Second one is we are using some counter or nonce. Okay, nonce-based approach. So nonce is counter can be a nonce. So every message, you're sending one message, then nonce value is increasing by one, for instance. Every time is changing. Okay, so this nonce n is not repeating. So there are two ways. One is nonce is counter. So every time nonce value is starting from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So every time it's changing, right? So that is also nonce. Or nonce can be randomly chosen, just like a randomized algorithm. Randomized algorithm case, nonce is chosen as a random. So then maybe with high probability, every time different ciphertext is generated. Okay. So nonce can be counter or nonce can be random. So anything is okay. So counter case, the sender and receiver has preserving the status of nonce value. So both are increasing the nonce synchronously. What we know is the system itself, the cipher system, is secure when nonce are chosen up. Adversarially, or nonce are chosen randomly. So every time different nonce is used, then the system is secure. Okay, so let's look at this example. F is pseudorandom function, and key space some R input and output. Actually, R is this is random nonce space, and this is output. Okay, so we are making the encryption scheme like this. There is R. R is just increasing by one, and output is R F K comma R X or M. So this is ciphertext. So this is a nonce-based encryption scheme. Is it secure or not? Yeah, it is also. Let's see. If the R space random part is very large, like R is like a 128-bit space, then the counter is not repeating, right? Maybe it's repeating after 1 to the 128, but it's a really large number. So practically, it's not repeating anymore. Okay. So we can say that this is secure because every time r is different. So r is different, that means f k comma r is different, is random. So new random is applied for every message. So we can say that this is secure cipher. So these two approaches are most popular things. One is r is chosen randomly, or r is just increased by one. It's a counter. It's random. Okay. So that's the typical mode. Okay. So every cipher looks like a very similar, right? We love the stream cipher, but actually pseudorandom function or pseudorandom permutation case also, we are using the similar approach. Instead of pseudorandom generator, we are just using the pseudorandom function, right? These are very similar things. Okay, so these are a little bit theoretical things, and next time we'll look at the practical secure mode, I mean the mode of operation for the block cipher. So we learn about the CBC mode and also counter mode. Okay, so today we learn about the deterministic counter mode. And next time we learn about the just counter mode and CBC mode. So this is one time key. And this is many time key. We are just using pseudorandom function or pseudorandom permutation to make this cipher system. Okay, any question? You know that you have a homework, right? Okay. So we will give another homework. Not today, I think, but maybe next time. Yeah, I will give another homework. Okay, no more question. Let me briefly say that the midterm things. I will upload the last year or previous year's exams also, and also the midterm will be online. Okay, online exam. And everything is open, so open book, open slide, and everything open, except you cannot be allowed to discuss with your friends, okay? So you cannot ask, but the others are open. Okay. And for the exam date, I will announce next time. Okay, any question? No question? Okay, yeah, see you next time, bye.